You've been in the, through this before. I mean, this is, as a documentarian, what is it like to kind of go through the, become part of somebody's life who's going through that kind of daily torture, really, and that kind of very intimate, personal passion, and to be a filmmaker?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think the films that I hopefully have made and want to continue to make, you know, are extremely personal, intimate portraits of people on some sort of journey. And, you know, this topic of Syria, this topic of ISIS, is so often relegated to headlines and to, you know, stats and photos. And I really wanted to put a human face to this in a very visceral way. And to do that, you know, I needed to be very intimate with my subjects, with Aziz and his colleagues. And, you know, that doesn't happen by just spending a couple weeks with people or knocking on the door and hanging out for a day. You know, this is trust that's built over months, you know, and I became a part of the fabric of their daily lives in order to get these, you know, extraordinarily intimate moments that I was seeking.
So how did that start? What was the first connection you guys made?
I was traveling around with Cartella in my last film, and ISIS was becoming front page news, and I started reading voraciously about the group and trying to understand this phenomenon, and read this piece in The New Yorker by David Remnick about this group, Raqqa, being slaughtered silently, a group of friends who banded together to expose the atrocities that ISIS was committing in their hometown of Raqqa. And just immediately upon reading it, I knew that this was my way into the story. I reached out to the guys through an organization that we knew in common, the Committee to Protect Journalists. Two or three of them, including Aziz, happened to be already be in exile, happened to be in the States. And so I think either that night or the next night, I was able to meet with them, tell them what I wanted to do. And then a week later, I started filming.
Mm. So what was that like having, I mean, I guess that was true. Maybe was Remnick actually physically around ever with you guys?
No, so like, yeah, so like we met him, we did the interview together, and like Matt read it, and then he reached us out through Committee to Protect Journalists. We met him, and he, like, before meeting him, we were not thinking to do any movie or documentary for like security reasons. And then when we met Matt, we knew that like the movie would be a good tool to tell or to spread our story out, so thousands and millions of people will be able to watch it, and through this documentary we'll be able to draw the attention of international community, people everywhere, NGOs, government. So we decided that we should make it, and then we, like a week later, we started to film together. So, and it's been like, first, like, you know, it started step by step, and then there was like a trustful relation between both of us, like RBSS on one side and Matt, and then like we agreed that he will film everything, and before screening the movie or before the movie will be done, we will sit together and we will see if there is like any security issues, anything. And like first time we watched the movie, none of us had any comments or anything, and we were surprised how good it is.
So did you watch Cartel Land in terms of making a decision, or was it because there was a relationship that Matthew had with other people that made him seem like a safe idea to at least initiate this relationship?
So Cartel Land was like one of the main things, because like when we met first Matt, we were thinking that we thought that we'll meet this like old movie director who spent like 70 years doing films. And then after we watched like the trailer of Cartel Land, first time we met, we knew that he's like professional. So then it was like one of the main reasons why we said yes. And then I was like, and like for me personally, I thought like Cartel Land is a Hollywood movie, it's not a documentary. And like I was asking like, oh, from where did you get like these professional people? And he told me it's like truth, like real. And then like that, like after that, like I watched Cartel Land like more than one time, and I told like my friends to watch it. So all that things together were like a reason to make this movie.
Who were you? I mean, one of the things that's interesting is the movie starts and there's kind of like this moment where it feels like the world shifts almost overnight in Raqqa. Was that true for you guys? Who were you guys before ISIS happened? So, were you rebels? Were you politically, you know, very into politics? And was that a constant issue? Were you
so
happy?
Yeah, so like before, like the Syrian revolution, like personally, I was like a biochemistry student, so I had nothing to do with politics. I had no political background, even my family, so I had nothing to do with politics. But when the Syrian revolution started, and somehow, like I joined the demonstrations early in the beginning, and later on, when the Syrian regime prevented the media, most of the international media organization to come and cover what's going on, and watching the local TV talking about what will happen to the earth if the sun will disappear, while the demonstration and the protests were all over the country, I decided to go by myself and film the demonstration. And then like sent it to the TV channels, and I was not the only one who's done that thing. Many of people, like all protesters, has done it. So we gathered together to establish like small media centers to report the news. And then like we went through all this journey until we got to the ISIS. So we decided to complete our work. So none of us studied like any media, any journalism, anything has to do with what we're doing right now. So my friends were like we supposed to be like lawyers, scientists, doctors, but in one point like we got to do this work. And right now like I haven't done anything with like with the biochemistry at all. So what I'm doing is like journalism, media, and it change our way, like the life, like it changed the way of our life. So I didn't think one day that I would be here, like with you talking about what's going on in Raqqa. None of my colleagues, my friends, we got like to meet NGOs, governments, everywhere. And then like we knew something new for us as people from Syria, from the Middle East. We used to know that only the old people who are like over 50 or 60 should talk about politics, should meet governments, should to like play a role in the future of the country, but we changed this rule. So my colleagues and I, our ages are between 18 and 28. So then it was like another thing we discovered. So we discovered many things. And we looking myself in 2011, 2012, even before, I can say that like I developed many things, like the way how I was thinking, how I'm thinking now. So, and it was like one example, like looking at on Facebook, they had like this new thing, like on this day, like what happened on this day, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years ago. Yeah. So like when I look at my boss, like 3 or 4 years ago, I say, I was like a bit stupid. So that helped us like in several ways. And right now, where we ended up, where we reach out, losing all these things, doing all these things, being following by ISIS, the most dangerous organization in the world, it changed our lifestyle. So I supposed to be studying or working a normal job. So, and right now I'm here.
So it sounds like when you guys got together for, you know, hamburger or whatever, you got falafel or a coffee or whatever, you weren't talking about politics in 6 years ago, 7 years ago.
No,
you'd be talking about movies, or you'd be talking about
girls,
music, or
how to steal money from my dad, travel to another city, like like things that teenager like do it. So and that like that changed like completely. So we don't feel that we're like young anymore. So
right.
We feel that we are like older than our age, like in 10, 20, 30 years, and that not only for only like with us, so it's with most of the Syrian people. I'm quite sure if you will bring like 12 years old Syrian child, he will be able to talk about politics, about like whatever. So that one of the things that the Syrian people have learned like the last few years.
So you were, so when this transition happened, was it instinctual? Was it, did you all just kind of like gather and kind of know that you had to do something, that you had to change how you saw the world, and that you just found like-minded people, or?
So the main thing that there was nothing planned at all.
Right.
So ISIS came. I didn't know, like, if you will ask me why you ended up as an activist or media man or whatever, I don't know. So something pushed me, like, to be an activist filming. So.
And the people you found who you became activists with?
Yes.
Were they having the same experience and you just kind of found each other on the streets?
Yeah, so that had, and like in the jails. So I got arrested 3 times and like most of my friends came from the jail. So we were like a political prisoners together. We were talking and then like after, like we met in the prison and when we were released, we met outside, we started like to develop the work. Mm-hmm. So. And so the thing, nothing was planned. ISIS came and we decided that we will not stop our work. It started as a revolution, something we believe in it. We lost many people, or like more than 500,000 Syrians have been killed during the revolution. So we decided that we will keep our fight to have it not only against Assad when ISIS came and to keep it against Assad and to added ISIS to it. Mm-hmm. So we completed the same thing. So we felt it's like kind of a duty that we should do, because we know that if we will keep silent, if we will not report about that things, it will be like only the regime propaganda, ISIS propaganda, and they will able to achieve their propaganda. So that was like the main thing why we decided to come together. It was like one night, like we had this call, we were like in different like cities, most of us were in Raqqa, and then we decided, okay, we need to do something, and all of us, we agreed. So the next day we started Facebook page, Twitter, and later on website. So it was like nothing planned. We didn't have like a strategy what to do that thing. It was just a call. Next day we started the Facebook page and we started to report.
So as you come into this place, it sounds like things had moved along. It sounds like they've been doing this for over a year at least at that point. So was it just finding your place in the group incrementally? I mean, it seems like you would almost become part of the family in a way. And it sounds like each person has their role to play within the group.
So, to clarify, I never was able to go to Raqqa.
Oh, you were never in? Okay.
I would be killed instantly. The reason the group was founded is because there's no media coming in, media going out. So there's no Western journalists, there's no journalists at all.
So did you guys shoot the footage under your kind of guidelines or suggestions or?
So they've been operating well before I started making the film within Raqqa.
Right.
And so a lot of the footage that they shot themselves within Raqqa.
But the footage of them, which is
footage outside of Syria is all shot by me.
Okay. So the footage in the rooms that they're in, if they're watching,
that's not in Syria.
That's not in Syria. So you shot all of that?
Yes.
So you were with them when they were out of Raqqa?
Correct.
Okay. So have you ever, you've not snuck into Raqqa to try to?
I would be killed instantly.
You'd get killed instantly. Is it that simple in all these places? Is there any question, are there any Americans at this point operating, hiding around and?
Well, there's currently a battle and within that U.S. funded
so the U.S. side.
Troops that are invading Raqqa as we speak.
So they're embeds. Are there embeds in that at this point?
Not really. I mean, this just started like a week ago. And so the fight for Raqqa will most likely take weeks or months. But that happened long after I stopped filming.
Okay. So is that a frustration to you or a...
Just the reality. I mean, when I started making the film, I envisioned it as this exodus story of them after members of the group were killed by ISIS. They were forced to flee. They were forced to flee Raqqa first to southern Turkey, then to other parts of Turkey, and then ultimately to Europe. And so I envisioned this film as this exodus of them on the run, being hunted by ISIS, going from safe house to safe house. And I was fascinated and stimulated by this sort of idea of this information war, this propaganda war, this war of ideas between ISIS's slick, almost Hollywood-like videos on one hand and RBSS's videos on the other hand, of trying to dispel this myth that ISIS had disseminated across the world, that they'd created a peaceful caliphate, a safe haven for Muslims, when in fact, you know, the reality on the ground was quite the opposite. And so that idea was you know, fascinating to me. But the film became much more than that. You know, it became an immigrant story. It became a story of, you know, rising nationalism in Europe. It became a story of trauma and cumulative effects of trauma. And so, you know, the film became many, many more things than what I thought it would initially would be.
So how do you adjust to, do you adjust to that on the run, or do you adjust to that in post and then start filling in the pieces?
As we go, you know. I think a mentor of mine in the film world once said, and I said this a lot with Cartelian as well, you know, if you end up with the story you started with and you weren't listening along the way, and I think that's good advice for life, and that's good advice for filmmaking, and something that I sort of hold, you know, close to my heart at every step along the way is being open to the story changing, being open to the, you know, I don't script anything, I don't, you know, have, you know, an essay that I'm trying to fulfill. I let the story evolve organically.
So when did it really change the most?
I mean, changed throughout the whole process of filming.
Because of what's going on with them, or because of what was going on in the outside world?
Both. Just, I mean, the reality of their, what was happening in their lives, and the geopolitical realities of what, you know, what's happening in Raqqa and with their group was changing as well. So a number of things were changing.
So what was the, was there any, how threatened were you, did you feel in the process of making the film, or did you?
So with my last film, Cardellian, I was, you know, in shootouts and meth labs and torture chambers and all sorts of extraordinary, you know, amounts of danger. This was much different. You know, they were the ones that are in danger. They're the ones that are being hunted. They're the ones that were killed by, you know, their group was being targeted by ISIS, and so...
But isn't proximity to them being one of them?
Sure, but you know, so you always felt the danger, you felt sort of this omnipresent feeling of ISIS being around, but I never actually saw them face to face. And so, you know, it was a different type of fear and a different type of danger.
And you still feel it daily?
What's it?
The sense of threat from ISIS?
It's like a daily thing that I have. So I get the threats daily. Sometimes, like, when I don't get it, I feel that there is, like, something wrong. It started to be, like, a normal routine. And then somehow, like, missing them doesn't make my day.
How do you get death threats? On Facebook or on... Do they have
Facebook,
your email?
Facebook, emails, Twitter, messages, all this type.
So do you try to change them or hide or do any of that, or you just kind of...
No, like, for, I was like, sometimes, like, if I'm like in a good mood, like, I make jokes about them. Sometimes I just block them, I just skip it.
Is there any time where you felt like you were ready to stop and just give up this issue?
No at all.
Do you see an end to it? Do you see an answer anywhere?
Sure, like, when we decided to do this thing, like, we knew that, like, we will win at the end, otherwise they will kill all of us. So we were so optimistic, so we have a hope that all that things will change one day. So, but we need to keep fighting for it. So doing all that things, all what we lost, all what we've done, all the things that we will do. So we know that one day ISIS will be defeated, Assad regime will be defeated, all other groups will be defeated. And what we were doing, like, trying to fight to go back one day to Syria. So personally, I'm so optimistic, and I'm sure that one day I will end up in Syria. So, but to end up in Syria, I need to do this thing. Otherwise, no one would do it. So, right. And if I will be killed, I will be killed, like, for something I believe in it. So, better than being killed, like, by car accident.
So, is there, in terms of the degree to which change is possible, or change will come, are ISIS and Assad equal? In terms of the problem at this point? I mean, ISIS obviously is different well, doesn't have necessarily different rules than Assad on some level, but I mean, are they, how can you see one going and the other one staying? Can you do both have to be eradicated to clear out Raqqa and Syria again?
So both of them, they should be defeated. So like the main problem started in Syria, it was because of Assad's regime. And the main thing that 95% and even more of the Syrian people who've been killed, they've been killed by Assad regime, not by ISIS.
Right.
So that the main, like the difference between both of them, that Assad regime has done all that things in undercover, underground jails. For ISIS, they made it for to the public. So it was like a tool for them. It was like a main thing to do with them as an organization or a group to do this public execution, to do these like high quality Hollywood videos to recruit people. So that's the difference between both of them. So both of them are bad, and both of them should be defeated because many people have suffered by both of them. And there are like other counter, there are like other cities where there is no ISIS, but there is like a Syrian regime and people, they're suffering from Assad regime and people, they are only suffering by ISIS. So both of them, they are like a creator of crisis, suffering for the civilians. So both of them, they should be defeated.
I think many people, especially Americans, think, you know, there's a silver bullet or that there's, you know, a quick fix. What's happening in Syria is so endlessly complicated. I mean, it's a 4 or 5 year civil war. It's a proxy war between Russia, Iran, Turkey, the US, the EU, and the Syrian government. You know, it's a vacuum of power through which extremist groups like ISIS have filled. So, you know, it's so complicated and there's no easy answer. And, you know, I think one of the things that Aziz and the guys in the group taught me, and it's, you know, become quite clear, is that two things. One, that we don't really have, we haven't really learned from our past mistakes in this region of there's not really a plan once we get rid of ISIS and a long-term strategy in the region in general. But more importantly and pertinent to the film is this idea that, you know, bombs are not going to fix ISIS, that ISIS is an idea, and this ideology lives with people all across the world, and especially in a whole generation of children that have been indoctrinated with it. And so we have to figure out ways to combat that. And I think the work of RBSS is one amazing way of doing that, and we have to continue to figure out other ways as well.
Mm-hmm. So I mean, if Assad could leave tomorrow, and ISIS would still be in there, and not, I mean, unless we put in some other regime, which is, we also have a terrible record of doing.
Well, ISIS is all over the world.
ISIS is going to be
in LA.
Yeah, but it's not like it's not in LA like it's in Raqqa, obviously. But I mean, is there an answer that America can move towards in terms of its philosophy that is some sort of, I mean, obviously not a silver bullet. It's obviously complicated, but is there something, what could we be doing better than we're doing? What is the call to action ultimately? I mean, this movie is a call to awareness, I think, as much as anything else.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a policy expert. This film is by no means even an examination of policy. So if people are hoping for that, expecting that, that's not this film. This film is a, you know, experiential journey into a group of amazing men and women who are fighting ISIS as citizen journalists. And for me, you know, it's so important to put a human face to these issues, and that hopefully people who see the film have a greater sense of empathy for this topic, for this issue, and they'll care a little bit more and they'll understand a little bit more. And that's really, I think, all you can ask. And that's my goal with this film.
Do you have something you would like America to be doing that we're not doing specifically, or?
Sure, like the American like strategy or policy dealing with the situation in Syria, like in Raqqa specifically, and even some other countries. So what they're what they're focusing on is like just to defeat the arms. So it started with Taliban, then Al-Qaeda, ended up with ISIS. So if they were able to kill the idea of Taliban from the beginning, the idea of Al-Qaeda would not ended up with ISIS. Right. But what they were focusing on all the time, just to defeat arms, just to defeat like groups. And they left the idea. And we've seen like ISIS everywhere. Like we've seen ISIS with the attacks in Europe, in US, in Asia, in Africa. So if ISIS for as an organization will be defeated one day, and we're sure about that thing. But the main thing, if the idea will not be defeated, and it should be defeated by an idea, so we will end up with a new kind of ISIS, maybe much worse than ISIS. Mm. So personally, when I was watching what's going on in Afghanistan, Osama bin Laden, Al-Qaeda, all that things, I was like kind of shocked. And right now, like, I consider Al-Qaeda as a civil society organization comparing with ISIS. So the thing, I'm so afraid that like later or like in the future, we will consider the same. Then you, so we'll have the same thing, like to consider ISIS as a civil society organization comparing with the new group. Mm-hmm. So the ideas, like among like thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in Raqqa and millions between Syria and Iraq, many thousands other around the world. So if they will not be educated, if you will not be aware about this thing, we'll end up with something like much worse. And like I'm not sure like if we'll, like if the international community of the world will be able to handle it or to stop it. So right now there is like effort, there is about to stop ISIS, other regimes, other like terrorist extremism groups in one point. But I'm so afraid about the future. So we don't need to focus just to defeat ISIS and like, okay, we'll have like 3 or 4 or 5 years relaxing, then we'll face another one. So the thing we need like just to kill the idea, then we'll have hopefully a peaceful world.
So is killing the idea, you kill the idea with a better idea?
Sure. The idea could not be killed by a weapon or like by rockets or by clashes. So it should be killed by an idea.
And do you think that's generational ultimately, that it's going to take another generation to make that step?
So it's up or depends on the effort. So if the international community will focus about this thing and it will be from the priorities, it could be done like in a couple of years. But if they will do the same process, the same thing like what happened with Taliban and Al-Qaeda, mm-hmm. it will take like generations and before getting to the point when the idea should be killed, another organization will rise up. Mm-hmm.
Well, and besides having a whole generation of children who've been indoctrinated with its ideology, you know, there's been more civilians killed in Raqqa in the past year, way more, by the international coalition than by ISIS themselves. And so, you know, that breeds more extremism, that breeds more anger, more distrust of the West, more hatred towards the West. And so, you know, I'm an eternal optimist, but I think you know, I don't see a ton of hope in the region, at least in the immediate future.
Well, the coalitions that are there, and all the sides of it, all seem to want to lie about what they're doing, what their motives are. Nobody seems to be playing it straight, which makes it seem almost impossible for us to have any of these groups to have a positive effect, because nobody wants to take responsibility when, you know, people are frowning on it. Everybody wants to act like they're heroes when they make a small, you know, step in a good direction, theoretically, and that seems to be. I mean, for me, from my perspective, certainly, it seems like that's the impossibility of the rest of the world having an influence. Is nobody seems to be truthful about it.
There's many issues, and that's for sure one of them. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So, does the United States seem frivolous to you as you're spending time here?
As a country, people, or government?
Yes. So, all of the above.
So for me, like in general, like, and I think like most of the people think the same, that governments are bad. So that's like something I kindly believe in it. And even if it's not bad, there is like they should they could be better. So the thing, like, I love the country as a country. It's like one of the best countries I have ever been. New York is like my favorite city ever. So people here are nice, so I show solidarity. And sometimes I feel sorry that these amazing people have this government.
Mm. Do you mean the one that's in power now, or the one in, or generally having a government the size of our government?
So Obama administration was not that good. So most of what happened in Syria and the region was because of Obama administration. So you, for me, like growing up as a kid or a child, I used to hear that U.S. is like the most power country in the world with Obama. All that thing changed. So people didn't trust you in the United States anymore. So he's been talking all the time about red lines, about many things, and he's done nothing. So people started to lose like the trust of U.S.
Mm-hmm.
And with the Trump administration started to change a bit, so he did like some actions, but it's not enough. So he acted when the Syrian regime used the chemical weapons, the chemical attacks. But like the Syrian people are being killed daily, like by warplanes, rockets, barrel bombs. So they should not wait for like only chemical attacks.
Right.
And like what's going on around the world in general is crazy. So I can't believe that we're living in the 21st century and we have like all that things happening. ISIS, what's going on with the government, like even UN, other organization. So sometimes I feel it's like kind of nightmare and like I need just to wake up from it.
Weirdly, we feel the same way a lot of the time. But I think it sounds to me like we're kind of naive the way you guys were before the revolution came.
Yes.
And we're kind of living, I mean, I assume Americans kind of seem that way. I mean, we get all worked up talking about little meaningless things and the bigger threat never gets talked about here.
Yes, true.
Do you think that, does it feel like we're in the same precipice that you were on in Syria?
Here in the U.S.?
Yeah.
I don't think so. So, like, sometimes even getting here to U.S., like, I should be stopped, like, 5, 6, 7 hours at the airport, and they know about my work, they know, like, I'm sure that they know every single thing about my life, so they know.
You're back watching the movie while you're in customs.
Yeah, so I know that they know, like, the name of the mother of my grandmother, which I don't know. So, but the thing, they have like all this process trying to protect the country. So, I think it's like so hard, but it could be. So, like what US has done with many countries, Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq. So, this could create like violations, violence everywhere. So people like maybe in a bomb point they will just boom and like we don't know what will happen. So personally, I didn't think that something will happen in Syria. One day we had like the Syrian regime had like the best intelligence in the world, like in the region, not in the world, and like we had like a strong army, all that things, but like we had a revolution. So no one knows what will happen in the future. Like maybe tomorrow US will end up with a revolution, changing president, doing something. So I believe that everything is possible.
Well, I think we're a little more awake than we were before Trump became president, but we're not fully conscious yet.
It's true. Like I didn't show solidarity with Muslim until Trump be a president. So like I was here in US, I traveled from Utah to DC, and like when I got to the airport, I saw like protesters at the airports are protesting like for the others, with signs in solidarity with Muslims. So I said, like Trump created a solidarity with Muslim no one ever had created.
Yeah, but now it's quieted down a little bit.
Yeah, and like one of the things that I liked here about the U.S. how like the people act. Like Trump came with the ban, and the people they went to the street. The court came, and they take the decision down. So the thing that's like good thing. Like even for us, like we need to learn about it for like the future of Syria. So in our region, we know that like all the power is under the president's hand. So and whatever the governments and the president want to do, it should be done. So here in the US, it's like completely different. Like we see like the rule of the people here, so it's like also a good thing to learn about it. And like the people who started to be more educated, people started to know what's going on in Syria, why Trump is saying that thing, and that was like also a good thing, like to have mm-hmm. like or like to rise up like the awareness in US.
Yeah, thank you, gentlemen, so much. Appreciate
thank
it.
You,
thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Sorry.